Wangige Market on the outskirts of Nairobi. It is a busy market day. And across the road, something interesting, a clinic of its kind. This is a plant health clinic, and a vegetable farmer is here to seek assistance for a spinach that seemed to be rotting away.
My spinach have been shrinking from the leaves.
What chemical do you use?
I have been mixing urea and CAN.
You should not mix. You should use urea alone or CAN alone. If you mix, you will interfere with soil fertility.
Plant health clinic is a relatively new concept in Kenya, but slowly taking root.
I was preparing land to plant, and there was a previous crop. I noted that my plants have a problem. So I came with a sample so that I may consult and maybe see how I can.
Under the program, farmers bring their affected crops to the plant clinics, where they are given recommendations by personnel referred to as plant doctors. The plant doctors accept queries on crops, diagnose a problem, write down a prescription containing recommendations which the farmer take away for action.
And what this is doing is providing a fixed location. So instead of having to visit farmer by farmer, you can in 2 or 3 hours get in contact with, say, 15, 20, 30 people.
The clinics were set up because the available extension workers were not enough to visit all farmers, given the vast terrains they had to cover. They are run by plant doctors, largely drawn from extension staff from the Ministry of Agriculture and the Kenya Agricultural Research Institute.
Well, the difference is that the people who run these things have not been trained in the same way. If you go to a doctor, they've had a long, structured training at university, registered with the Kenyan Medical Association. We don't have that with plants.
We just tell them the problem and the spray to buy, the rate of application, and the post-harvest interval. Then after that, we do follow-up.
In case of problems that are beyond their diagnosis, they refer to other institutions. Since Wanjiku began attending the plant clinic, she has received valuable advice for her one-acre farm. But besides lack of money to buy fertilizers and pesticides, small-scale farmers have small sizes of farms, thus rotation of crops is not always possible, making the crops vulnerable to nematodes, which are the biggest threats to plants. Nematodes are worms living in the soil. They are too small to be seen by the naked eye.
In fact, the aim here is to use pesticides in a more smarter way, so that you don't overdose or underdose.
Many of the Kenyan small-scale farmers rely on their crops for survival, and for them, plant pests and diseases are a constant threat. So, do these clinics work?
Yeah, I'm happy. Yeah, it works. Yeah. Because whenever I go and practice and wait and see the results, I find that the results are okay.
The extension services have been useful for farmers, especially those in the rural areas. The concept first started in 2003 and promoted by KBC Global Plant Clinic based in Bolivia. It was piloted in Bangladesh and Nicaragua. So far, there are up to 100 plant clinics operating in India, Nepal, DR Congo, Sierra Leone, and Kenya.
With access to services such as plant health clinics, farmers are able to tackle pests and diseases, which in turn will help to produce better yields, thus helping to promote food security. Rosalia Opondo for Earthwatch in Wangige.
Deep in the heart of Nairobi's Huruma Estate, and Mary Mshina and her group are busy rummaging through heaps of garbage. They are searching for any plastic waste which will be put to good use. After collecting all plastics they can lay their hands on, they proceed to a humble room which does not have much space but will do just fine. The paper is first sorted, then washed to remove all the dirt.
The recycling process takes place at a very domestic level here in this small factory. No machines, not even protective gloves.
Si kwamba hatuogopi, lakini ni kwa sababu hatuna hizo gloves kwa wakati huu.
Plastic paper is dried and cut into small pieces manually.
Tuvitu tudogo tudogo na tunatumia tu makasi. Kwa hivyo unapata mtu haizi kuwa na uwezo wa kutengeneza yani gunia mzima kwa siku.
They are then mixed with paper that has been soaked in water, adding sawdust and charcoal dust to it. The combination is mixed into a fine broth. Soily sieve to remove impurities and added to the mixture, acting as glue to hold together the mixture. For the Joyful Country Rainbow Project, as they are known, the sky is the limit. Their vision stems from the theory that a clean environment brings forth happy people.
Tulipokuwa tunaanza, tulikuwa tunatafuta kuwa joyful country.
And set forth to fulfill their mission of cleaning up their surrounding. When the mixture becomes solid enough, it is rolled into pieces and dried. When the briquettes dry well, they burn without smoke.
Unaweza kausha kwa jua kama uko na wakati, lakini kama hauna wakati, yale ambayo ulikuwa umekausha kwa jua ukiweka kwa jiko, unaweka ile ingine chini ya jiko. Hasa wakati unapika na hii, na hiyo ile joto iko chini, inaendelea kukausha ile ingine.
The 20 members work here on a voluntary basis and have been around for 1 year. They share out the briquettes between the members. They no longer use other forms of energy such as kerosene to cook. For now, the group is seeking out ways to expand the business and make the briquettes for sale. The most urgent for them would be a crushing machine to reduce the manual work done. Estimates indicate current generation rate of plastics is almost 1 million tons per annum in Nairobi alone. Plastics constitute approximately 20% of the urban waste generated in Nairobi every day. But this, against a low level of recycling and reuse, points to an evident need for policy on management of the flimsy polythene.
Starehe Success Story, or SSS, is the name that this group has given to this unique kind of briquettes. They are hoping to rid their estate of all the plastic waste, and this goes a long way to show that effective waste.
Environmental degradation in Kenya comes from rampant deforestation, leading to droughts, floods, soil erosion, and increased human poverty. To counter deforestation and conserve the ecosystem, Kenyans are embracing the culture of production of tree species, especially in the drylands. Melia volkensi, almost similar to mahogany, is one such indigenous tree species.
Our interest in Melia as a tree crop is based on the fact that in dryland ecosystems, such as this area, Kibwezi area, the greater Makueni, you do not have a lot of options in terms of the range of species that you can easily grow here.
Jonathan Kituku is a Melia farmer in Kibwezi. He has over 12,000 Melia trees, which have grown from a colony of about 400 only in the last 6 years.
Huyu ni mti fani sana kwa sababu huyu mti siwezi ambia mtu ya kwamba huyu mti una hasara kwa sababu ni mti ambao liwi na mtwa. Ni mti ambao sio sana sana kuwa kuliwa na jua. Na ni mti sio sana sana kuchota maji kuja kuweka. Ni mti tu ukinyeshewa siku moja basi.
He expects to earn much money when the trees mature for harvest. He, alongside other farmers, have been receiving extension services from the Kenya Forestry Research Institute to train them on best farm practices such as spacing and pruning to avoid competing with other crops for light.
Kila mwaka siku hizi napanda kila mwaka 3,000, 2,000, 4,000 namna hiyo kulingana na uzito wa fedha kwa sababu miti sio kitu rahisi, ni kitu expensive kulingana vile nimegundua sasa.
Melia is widely considered as a potential plantation and agroforestry species in the semi-arid areas. The tree takes 10 to 15 years to mature. However, selected harvesting can be done after 8 years. However, it has not been widely planted owing to its germination dormancy. But careful researchers have developed techniques to enhance Melia germination and the use of locally available materials such as cow dung, sand, soil organic matter, ash and wastewater are beneficial.
We have to rapidly recruit Melia into the farming systems. That is why we have been working on testing various provenances, various varieties of Melia. We are collecting the seed of Melia from wherever it is growing in this greater area, trying to bring them into the nursery, trying to understand the genetic constitution.
Farmers have been relying on traditional methods of raising Melia vulcanii seedlings, which heavily depend on natural regeneration. But plants are underway to domesticate the tree to maximize on its benefits. Melia is used for timber, fodder, fuel wood and wood carving. Farmers are urged to intercrop with other plants. By promoting tree cultivation, farmlands enhance nutrient cycling, pest control, pollination and biodiversity conservation, which assist in creating the conditions needed for food.
For farmers in the drylands, a failed harvest can mean months of malnutrition and hardships. But when trees are intercropped with food crops, then farmers are likely to get a reprieve because the trees are likely to survive months of drought owing to their hardiness. Rosalia Pondo for Channel 1, Earthwatch.
Inside the pristine Mrima forest in Malindi, the sound of noisy machines welcomes you. Workers are busy on a site which turns out to be the center of a controversy among community members. Suleiman and his friends are not happy about this investment site. Residents here claim they one day woke up to find machines ready to work. The claims are corroborated by the National Museums of Kenya, which says the geological formation of Mrima, which supports minerals, has renewed the clamor for mining. The National Museums, in a letter, said the company specified a different exploration site. Some members of the community, however, welcome the project. Pristine and preserved are words that describe the untouched parts of Mrima. It supports plenty of biodiversity, with over 50% of Kenya's rare plants found here. Mrima also contains a kaya, or a sacred site of importance to the local Digo community. But this is a forest that has rendered them strangers in their homeland. In July 2008, 10 kayas were listed as UNESCO World Heritage Sites due to their outstanding environmental, cultural and spiritual value. Kayas, which are spread along the Kenyan coast, have a powerful link to the past history of the Mijikenda community after their immigration from Shungwaya in the late 17th century. Thank you. all the community is asking for is consideration and to be allowed to participate in decision making. Environmentalists are also concerned about continued destructions of forests and the implications for the future. Rosalia Pondo for Channel One Earthwatch.
Trees are known to provide energy in form of firewood and charcoal for both rural and urban households. But sadly, trees have fallen prey to unscrupulous loggers who harvest them for sale in the construction industry. This unscrupulous business has led to clearing of vast areas of forest cover to pave way for farming activities. The best case being the Mau Forest, which is currently undergoing rehabilitation after the government rescued it from its deathbed. Now the Environment Management Authority is asking Kenyans to help increase the forest cover, which currently stands at less than 3%, to at least 10% that is recommended by the United Nations. NEMA Director General Dr. Ayub Masharia says Kenya needs to plant at least 7.6 billion trees before the year 2030 to reverse the worrying trend.
Like now we have directed the Kenya Forest Service to make sure that there is nobody grazing in our forest because we don't want the trees to be damaged. Who is supposed to plant the trees? It is us people, because it is our country. It is us who want to implement the new constitution. The trees are here to serve us.
This, he says, will help to maintain a healthy and strong interdependent ecosystem. According to the Director General, the threat of desertification is real, coupled with the effects of changing climate and erratic weather patterns. Each of the 38 million Kenyans, including older persons and infants, have to plant at least a tree a month for the 12 months in a year to achieve the tree cover.
You find that every year we are supposed to plant 12 trees, every person, including the children, the adults, everybody, including the elderly. We need to plant one tree per person per month.
Trees act as a sink for gases that would otherwise be dangerous to the environment and human habitation. Greenhouse gases, including carbon dioxide, are currently a major concern, and environmentalists say increasing vegetation cover through planting trees is the best way to absorb the harmful gases. Forests enable great biodiversity of both plants and animal species. Forest trees store large amounts of water. Because of their large size, they are therefore important regulators of the hydrological processes, which leads to the formation of rain. For Earthwatch, I'm Judith Akolo.
It is a hot afternoon in Makueni, and Sarah Masila cheerfully inspects her crop. It has been 6 months of labor, and the pigeon pea is ready for harvest. A season that befits the Westling and cheer that these farmers exude. Down the road, Josephine Kimeu clutches tightly to her jembe. The temperatures will not dampen her spirits. These pigeon pea farmers have been cultivating the crop for 4 years and are now reaping the benefits.
Mvua haikui mingi, lakini tukipanda baadhi na ime, inakuwa vizuri kuliko tuseme mahindi.
Sarah Masila, a farmer, sells the crop in Mombasa at a profit of 50 shillings. A kilo used to go for 30 shillings, she says, but now we get 50 shillings in the market. There is little rain here, she says, but when we plant pigeon peas, it does better than other crops such as maize. Pigeon peas characterized as an orphan crop since it has been neglected. Few people conduct research on it on a part-time basis, and research is recent. Yet, these crops are important for food and nutritional security and have markets. These farmers know this only too well.
Kitambo, The old variety takes long. We used to stay hungry. The improved variety matures faster. Through this crop, I have educated my children and built my house.
The International Crops Research Institute for Semi-Arid Tropics, ACRISET, develops improved disease-free and fast-maturing pigeon peas.
The major challenge now is the pest. And we have seen in a place like India, sometimes they do spraying about 12 times. But we have worked a system where we make sure that if they're going to spray, they spray 2 to 3 times only. So the level is low.
Sarah, a beneficiary of these varieties, explains that they mature at different times, hence do not create excess produce in the market, as opposed to the traditional variety. ACRISET Director for Eastern and Southern Africa, Dr. Said Selim, has been working with these farmers for more than 10 years.
Farmers have had every year pigeon pea when other crops have failed, so provide them with food security. It is the only source of protein for them. They cannot afford animal protein.
The pigeon peas have stems which provide a source of fuel once dry. After the new varieties are developed, under irrigation at Kiboko Station, located 160 kilometers from Nairobi, they are evaluated under drought conditions in Makueni.
These varieties, if you see, the pod is hard, and therefore those insects do not like hard pods. They like soft pods to eat very quickly and get into the seed.
Rain is unpredictable, and once drought sets in, sand is what is left of rivers. Dr. Selim explains that pigeon peas are useful for their ability to fix nitrogen into the soil from the atmosphere through nodules in the roots. The crop uses the fixed nitrogen, and between 30 to 50 kilograms per hectare is the excess which is left behind for other crops to use later in the same field as nitrogen fertilizer. Infrastructure remains a challenge, and farmers have to navigate the rough terrain on bicycles to take their perishable produce to the market. ACRISET assembles the farmers into groups through which they sell their produce in bulk.
And although we do have poverty, poor growth, and we need to work with our small-scale farmers, let's think about what we do with our medium and large-scale farmers. The incentives we need to create so that they can produce surplus for us into the market.
Once you have created these markets and productivity goes up in production, definitely you are having use for those areas where farmers were producing almost nothing, and there's a pool for that, so production goes up.
This has eliminated middlemen who used to exploit them. Farmers like Peter Mutier have benefited from this organized marketing. It is a case of linking knowledge to policy and action for food, and this has helped to develop varieties that are suited to the dryland conditions, thus benefiting the people of Makueni. Rosalia Pondo for Channel One Earthwatch. Cabbages are one of the most important cash crops in Africa, but also attract a wide range of pests, leading to loss of yield. Grace Wanjiko is a farmer in Wengige on the outskirts of Nairobi and knows only too well why she must safeguard her crop.
I am not sure what disease affects my crops, but sometimes the vegetables turn yellow.
Wangari, a farmer, plants traditional vegetables and kales. Pests attack the kales, she says, leaving a white residue. The price of pesticides is exorbitant, but these farmers have no choice.
The worst of them all is the white fly. If you spray the fly, it disappears and then reappears after a few days.
Among the most common problems affecting cabbages and tomatoes include the bollworm, which causes holes in tomatoes, the diamond back moth, and aphids. But these farmers may have a reason to smile soon, courtesy of a new technology that is currently being tested. Research underway at the Kenya Agricultural Research Institute, KARI, shows that a modified form of the mosquito net can be used to protect cabbage plants from pests and diseases.
Release of certain smell by the chemical. So, and this chemical, then that smell prevents the insect from coming closer to the nets. So the first thing, more or less like 90% of the effects of the chemical is repelling. So you just pull the pest away.
The crops also mature faster because of moisture retention, high temperature, and high rate of carbon dioxide inside the net. But insect-proof screens under tropical conditions usually pose the challenge of overheating and excessive shade. To prevent this, the net is removed during the day when most insect pests are less active.
Because for crop like tomatoes, you require pollinators so that you can fertilize your flowers and you can have fruits. So if you open it 3 times, we allow pollinators to come in. We also allow natural enemies so that we don't need to use chemicals on those pests that have gotten. The natural enemies can feed on those pests.
Traditionally, bed nets are used to trap and prevent mosquitoes from biting human beings and infecting them with malaria, a deadly tropical disease. So I was curious to know why an institution would want to engage in such waste. Well, Dr. Mu explains that people should not use their mosquito nets to protect their crops since that might increase the risk of malaria. The nets used in agriculture, he says, are modified nets, cheaper and lower in quality. They cannot be used to prevent mosquitoes because they have bigger pores which would allow the vectors to penetrate. As such, the researchers are not worried that people will stop using the nets to prevent mosquitoes.
The crop takes a longer time, 4 weeks. But in the crops that are under the net, it took us like 2 weeks to 3 weeks and we had to transplant them because they were already really grown up.
The research was informed by the adverse effects caused by continued use of pesticides.
If you take your crops to the market and you say you use pesticides, people will not buy your product. They believe it causes disease in human beings.
Product to be used safely on edible crops, you have to take into account what you call residue levels. So in essence, what it means, if you respect what you call the pre-harvest interval, this is the time between the time of application and the time of harvest. The product should have safely broken down to levels that are harmless to the person who is going to consume the produce.
When used continually, pests develop resistance.
Rotation of the crop. This helps to avoid something we call delay or delaying the development of resistance to pests and disease. This will arise from continual use of the product.
The efficacy of nets in agriculture was first investigated in Benin in 2003, and the technology is under investigation into other research sites in Kenya, after which farm implementation trials will commence. Ordinarily, tomatoes take an upwards of 3 months before they can be harvested. But this new technology has proved that tomatoes can take considerably shorter time in the field, and the advantage is that pests and diseases can be controlled without the use of pesticides. Rosalia Opondo, Channel One News, Adhikari Headquarters, Nairobi. Voi is a rocky town in the coast of Kenya, almost a semi-arid area. Huge pieces of land with equal portion of rocks dot the land in Maungu near Voi, making agriculture a not-so-profitable activity. But that notwithstanding, they are using the land for a new cash cow, aloe vera farming. Aloe thrives well in dry areas and is famous for its medicinal and beauty products.
We normally experience rain shortage, but the little rainfall we get is sufficient to grow aloe.
We find Celestina Maganga busy at work on her aloe farm.
Hii sehemu ambayo iko hapa nyuma ni mitungi ambazo nimekata na nikaweza kuweka mchanga, nikachanganya na mbolea, alafu nikamwaga hizi mbegu ambazo mnaziona hapa. Wakati nimeweka hizo mbegu ninafinika na nyasi, alafu ninamaliza wiki moja na nusu hizo mbegu zitakuwa zimeota. Wakati zimeota ninatoa hiyo nyasi na iweka kando, alafu nitaendelea kumwaga maji hapo. Kiasi cha mwaka mzima. Wakati nimemaliza mwaka mzima, hiyo mche utakuwa umefikisha inchi mbili ama tatu.
It is harvesting time. Celestina is a member of the Maungu Aloe Group formed 5 years ago. The harvesting is done manually, a slow and tedious task, but one that is paying off. Extracts from the plant are used to make a variety of soap for washing clothes, medicinal bathing soap, and an assortment of beauty products. After manually harvesting aloe, the sap is mixed in a basin and the right and correct quantities of chemicals added.
Then we mix it together with other ingredients And then we now make our products like, now this is soap.
Aloe has immense benefits to this community. After processing the sap, they get soap. They no longer have to buy processed washing soap. Neither do they have to travel long distances to buy other beauty products.
Kwa kupata lita moja, ninakata hizi jani 83, ndiposa zinanipa lita nzima. Na kwa kutengenezea bidhaa hizo, hiyo lita nzima, inaweza kukupatia hata zaidi ya 10,000.
Eva Kiseu is a trainer helping to facilitate the cultivation and production of final aloe product. The group has grown to 55 members and they are setting their eyes on expanding the market base to other counties across Kenya. They are hoping to tap into the Innovative Fund for Agriculture and Agribusiness in order to expand their business. Aloe remains an endangered crop in Kenya, protected by the Kenya Wildlife Service under the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species Societies. The perennial crop takes 4 years to mature and can reproduce for up to 25 years. But with responsive and sustainable cultivation, then the crop is set to bring fortunes to more people like Celestine Meganga and the Maungu Aloe Group, who live in arid lands that cannot accommodate agriculture. Rosalia Pondo for Channel 1 Earthwatch. Wood and charcoal burning has been a rampant vice in Kenya, leading to massive destruction of water towers. Mau Forest, the largest water tower, is a classic example of the extent of environmental degradation. Besides the government's resolve to reverse this trend, there are other initiatives in the grassroots level that are geared at reducing demand for wood. Deep in the heart of the Rift Valley, women in Aina Moi area have devised an alternative cooking method using little firewood.
Tulianza hii kwa kikundi, tukiwa watu 10. Tukaendelewa, tukawa karibu 20, na ndio tumeendelea, mpaka tukafundishwa jinsi ya kutumia jiko. Jiko hiyo vile inaweza kutengenezwa ili kuni isiende nyingi. Kama uko na shughuli ya biashara, nafasi ya kwenda kutafuta kuni nyingi kulete nyumbani na kuwa shida. Alafu tukaona tukitengeneza hiyo jiko, tutatumia kuni chache na ukiendeleza kazi yako ya biashara.
The food is cooked for a short while in a controlled jiko, then left to simmer in a fireless basket cooker.
Na hiyo karibu kuni mbili au tatu, chakula imechamka na imesha kuwa tayari.
Si kama zamani ulikuwa unakata kuni nyingi yenye utatumia, ni kuni kidogo. Kiasi kidogo. Tena hata ukiweka chakula kwa hiyo meko, haiwezi kuchoma watoto. Utajua tu wenyewe watakuja, wapague, hakuna kuchomeka. Uko waredi huko nyuma, neno inaweza kufanyika hapana.
The project was initiated by Tumaini Women Group with support from a local NGO, Nature Kenya. The basket cooker has revolutionized the modern day hot pot. The baskets are woven using reeds and blankets, and up to 99% of the heat is conserved. This practice of conserving energy at a domestic level is a clear indication of increased awareness on the importance of protecting our natural resources. The women group described the fireless furnace basket as a godsend project which has helped improve their livelihoods.
Sababu moja hapo ya kwa nini huu msitu wa South Nandi ulikuwa ukiharibiwa ilikuwa pia ni kwa sababu ya umaskini.
The baskets cost as little as 200 shillings to weave, but can fetch as much as 1,000 shillings in the market depending on size.
Wakiuza kwa njia hiyo, wanaweza kupata pesa za kutumia kwa njia zao ama kwa matumizi yao mbalimbali nyumbani.
The natural forest cover of South Nandi Forest is the water catchment of several rivers feeding Lake Victoria, which also hosts medicinal plants.
Msitu wenyewe ulikuwa ukiathiriwa sana kwa uharibifu kwa njia ya ukataji wa makaa, ukataji wa mbao, na pia ni mambo ya kuua ndege na wanyama pori. Na hayo ndiyo mambo yote ambayo yakatufanya kwamba tuweze kuja hapa South Nandi.
The initiative has helped to increase bird life in the area, an indication of a healthy environment. Rosalia Opondo, Channel 1, Earthwatch. Thomas Kirubi is a eucalyptus farmer in Mathioya area of Murang'a. Kirubi feels the pinch of cutting down eucalyptus trees that were once an investment to him. He has, however, come to appreciate the decision he took.
majani ya chai ilikuwa imepungua. Lakini wakati sasa miti ilikatwa, kwa huu kilo za majani ya majani imekuwa mingi.
We caught up with Moses Waihiga, bringing down eucalyptus trees that he has grown for years. He now describes the tree as a selfish plant.
Na tena majani yake ni ikianguka tu kwa chini, inakava hapo chini kama nylon. Kwa hivyo hakuna kitu kinaweza kuwa.
Eucalyptus is the most economically viable option for farmers, and studies show that a farmer can earn more by planting the species compared to other crops. But the problem with eucalyptus is that it sucks up huge amounts of water from the soil.
It is fairly fast growing. And to be able to grow and support the growth, it generally outcompetes other plants that it's growing with in terms of the requirements for nutrients.
And because of this, the two farmers abandoned eucalyptus farming after the government launched guidelines. The policy outlines suitable areas for planting the tree, which include areas degraded through soil erosion and loss of soil fertility, areas with saline soils, farmlands, and ash plantations.
Our advice in this regard has been that farmers should endeavor to replace eucalyptus where they are growing in sensitive areas where they are detrimental to the environment.
As we were moving up, you could see some places are still having eucalyptus because they are far away from wetlands.
When exposed to water, the roots absorb water, earning it the name Munyomai, meaning the water absorber in a local Kenyan dialect.
The eucalyptus tree was introduced in Kenya as an exotic species from Australia. Would you say that this was a good idea so far?
So it was important to have introduced eucalyptus because it's a fast-growing species, so that to reduce the demand of wood energy, which would have come then from our indigenous forest. So it was quite important to have introduced eucalyptus in the country from that perspective of our growing demand for energy for the industry, and as the commercial needs for our wood resources continued, even in the construction industry, in the building industry, in the paper, we find that eucalyptus has contributed a lot in the supply of these resources.
That the tree has a taproot that penetrates deep into the soil, and thus it is important to plant the tree in places where it doesn't compete with other plants or where little else will grow.
If you have a child that grows very fast, that child eats a lot of food, and that is exactly with the eucalyptus.
Water trickles away from the fresh log he just felled. The drops are pointed to the amount of water the tree absorbs. The damage it poses is evident in River Mathioya, whose levels had drastically reduced. But the corrective measures are bearing fruit. Swamps and springs are rising again, and this is a good aroma for the tea industry, which is a major economic activity in the area. Kanyenyini Tea Factory in Kangema is one of the major beneficiaries of the felled wood. The eucalyptus policy also demands that trees be eliminated from the ground completely in some areas. But this will be no mean feat, as seedlings sprout from the main logs in which the trees are cut, making it difficult to eliminate. Some farmers have resorted to applying oil and salt that forces the trunk to rot and decompose after a while. But this mode of getting rid of trunks is discouraged because it's harmful to the soil. Rosalia Pondo for Channel 1 Earthwatch.